You're listening to the Final Draft Insider View, the podcast where we talk to screenwriters about screenwriting and their military careers. Well, okay, usually we don't do that last part, but this time we are going to do that because we have on Chris Roessner, who has written a great movie coming out on Netflix April 21st called Sandcastle, and we're going to be talking to him about that today. Chris, thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, thanks for having me, man. I'm really excited.
So let's start... I kind of want to start with the military stuff because it's just such an interesting foray into writing.
Yeah.
So how did you, you joined the military at what, 17?
Yeah, I was 17 when I joined. I had to wait till I was, I think, 18 to go to basic training. So I was a little bit ahead of the curve, you know?
Mm-hmm. So what made you join?
I've been trying to figure out for the past 10 years or so, like, what was the real motivation for joining the military. I think on the surface level, I wanted to pay for college. I got into USC film school. I'm the first person in my family to go to college. So it was a really big deal, but we sure as hell couldn't afford it. I mean, I remember getting the application, not the application, but getting the acceptance letter, and I'm sitting in my living room with my mom and my stepdad, and it's the happiest day of my life. And I'm looking across the table, and I could kind of realize that they weren't sharing in my happiness, really, you know, and I couldn't figure out why. And then I got to the final page, and it was the dreaded tuition page. And my mom and stepdad looked at me, and they said, you know, this is great, but we can't afford to buy a ticket for you to fly out to Los Angeles and look at the school, let alone attend it. So I got pissed off about that for, you know, 3 days, because the way that I saw it is I held up my end of the bargain. I did well in high school. I got what I wanted, so somebody owed me film school. And I went into a recruiter and I basically said, listen, if I sign up, can I attend USC film school? And I'm sure the recruiter's eyes just lit up because I gave him the answer to the test. He was like, hell yeah, man, come right on in, you know? And like, in hindsight, I'm sure if I walked in and I said, you know, I really want to be an octopus, he'd be like, oh man, the military has a great octopus program. Absolutely. You know? So I'd signed up, initially to pay for college, but like one of the things that I've learned after the fact is that my biological father, who I didn't meet until I was 27, was a West Point guy and a Special Forces guy, and then worked in intelligence in DC for a long time. And I had built this guy up in my mind my entire life. And the first time that I reached out to him was via email from the presidential palace in Iraq. Wow. And 10 years later, I realized that probably wasn't an accident. You know what I mean? I feel like, you know, again, the surface level, I joined because I wanted to pay for film school. But I also think the much deeper level is I was trying very hard to earn the right to have a conversation with my dad.
Right. I mean, now you're like, you were on equal footing in some way.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, again, I spent a good portion of my life just building this guy up. And, you know, I often say I probably got bullied into joining the military by the ghost of a dad I never met.
Right, right. Wow. Well, let's back up a second then. This was all to get to USC Film School, and you got in. Obviously, you went later.
Yep.
So what made you want to get into film school? What made you want to get into this career?
I think I'm just one of those very odd kids that always knew that this is what I wanted. And I feel like, given I grew up in a very... what's the genteel way to put this? Economically disadvantaged neighborhood, you know? The house I grew up in legitimately cost $5,000. And we didn't have a lot of money, and I used to paint curbs. I used to paint, like, you know, the addresses of the houses in the neighborhood, and they'd pay me $5, you know, to paint the address on the curb. And we had a video store called Video Time where, you know, if you gave them $5, you could rent 5 movies for 5 days. And I think that's kind of where I escaped to. You know, I think it's pretty common if you are kind of a nowhere kid from a nowhere place, the movies can kind of open the world up for you. And it definitely did that for me. So I knew early on that's what I wanted to do. But I also luckily knew that there is a massive gap between being a fan of film and being a filmmaker. And I desperately wanted to traverse that gap. And again, it just so happened that the military was the way to do it.
Yeah. I mean, that's an atypical career path for sure. So let's talk about when you got out of the military, you go to USC right away?
Yeah, I went to USC. Well, I shouldn't say right away, because I came back, and for the first 3 days of being home, I felt a little bit I guess, off, you could say. Something wasn't right. I wasn't assimilating well. I called some of the other guys I served with, and they were experiencing the same thing. And what we kind of realized is that we had this desire to serve, and we felt like we just served our country, but it also was kind of mired in, like, red tape and bureaucracy, and, you know, it was morally gray. Like, were we doing the right thing? Did we help? Did we not? So I didn't go to USC right away. I ended up going to Nepal for about 3 months, and I did some volunteer work there. And by the way, like, if there happens to be, by any miracle, any military veteran listening, I can say with absolute certainty that if you join the military, you probably have a desire to serve. And if you're having trouble assimilating, it's probably because you need to serve someone else again in, like, a you know, less, you know, morally encumbered way. So I did that for several months, and then I went to USC, and I'm glad I did, because I had to get my head on straight before I could even focus on learning about, you know, Citizen Kane. You know what I mean?
Right. That makes a lot of sense. Yes. Before you start sinking into movies. So what was your experience like going to college at that point? I mean, you're a little bit older than the other kids. Did you start in undergrad?
Yeah, I did. I got my undergraduate degree in poetry, which was totally unexpected. You know, it was sort of that classic college story where you have a class that, you know, is, I think it was like a mandatory class to get like an English degree or something. And I was just blown away by it. And I think what it was is the teacher knew that I had just gotten back from Iraq and, you know, gave me a lot of great novels and great works of poetry from these, you know, post-World War II, post-World War I writers. And I felt like totally connected to them, even though, like, we were, you know, 80, 90, 100 years apart or what have you. And at USC, I didn't really run into, at that time, any other war veterans. So I didn't feel as connected to the student body as I was hoping. Mm-hmm. And again, that maybe has something to do with the fact that I was older, but I just kind of fell in love with these voices on the page. And that became my major. And I think that was another thing that probably, you know, put my head on straight.
Wow. You really do learn to express yourself just with words.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's what that's all about. So what about grad school? Why? And you continued at USC, right?
I did. I knew that I wanted to go to the Peter Stark Producing Program, which for people that don't know, it's like, I kind of compare it to Hollywood's version of an MBA. I often like joke and say I can run a studio, but I can't run a laundromat. You know what I mean? It's like very it's very specific and tailored to you know, what it means to navigate Hollywood. And, you know, I knew that I wanted to be a writer, but I'd already spent 4 years like workshopping poems and workshopping short stories and all this sort of stuff. And I'd been interning, you know, at different jobs all around town for a while. And I realized that there's this whole other aspect of the film business that is just as important as what you're writing. And what I mean by that is you can be a hell of a writer and you can write a great script, but navigating it through the machinations of this giant town can be quite treacherous. So I wanted to get as many skills as possible to give me a fighting chance, because again, there's really no way to navigate what you intended all the way through the process of making a film. But I at least wanted to be in the fight, so to speak. I at least wanted to have the skills to be in the arena so that my voice was being heard. Because you hear all the stories about you write a screenplay and then it becomes something else entirely. And I didn't want to spend my life writing, you know, what I think were really great scripts and becoming really bad movies. You know what I mean? I didn't want that.
Right. So what are the kind of skills did you want to pick up?
So a lot of the focus of the curriculum was on, you know, understanding, this is probably the best way to put it, understanding what the priorities are of every in particular, any job in particular, right? So a agent looks at films different, and they are incentivized to, but actors look at films different, writers look at films different, directors and studio executives, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I think it's important to know that, you know, I think when a writer starts their career, their impulse is to think everybody's an idiot and no one knows what they're doing and why can't they see what I see and blah, blah, on and on and on. And they like start to attack people personally. Mm-hmm. And which, by the way, isn't to say that this town isn't filled with idiots. I mean, they're all over the place. But what makes it easier is to recognize, like, from this person's perspective, there is something that they need that they're not getting. And I have to either help them get that or help them get over it, right? So I can move on to something else that's more important, right? So I think, like, from 30,000 feet, the START program was fantastic. It just gave me a straightforward understanding of what it means to be an executive and an agent, and how it is one can have different priorities, but that doesn't make them a bad person, doesn't make them an idiot. It's just their job is different and they're incentivized for different things.
Right. I mean, that's that perspective that then you can use to navigate those meetings and navigate those pitches and understand people's perspectives.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it'll make you a better filmmaker. It'll make you more collaborative. And most importantly, it'll keep you sane, you know?
Right. So what happened after grad school?
So after grad school, it's the worst time in pretty much anybody's life, regardless of whether you go to film school or anything else, because you probably have this scary couple months where you don't know what's going on. And I was no exception to that. But after a couple months of applying for jobs, I got hired to be an assistant to this producer named Mark Gordon, who's an EP on Sandcastle, but he also produced Saving Private Ryan, for example. I mean, he's been around for a long time and knows what he's doing. And he hired me to be his assistant. And I sort of thought I'd work that job for a while and maybe I'd be promoted to be an executive, and I'd be an executive for a short period of time, and then I'd transition over to writing. But after about 3 or 4 months on the desk, I was like, holy shit, I need to get out of here. You know what I mean? Like, this is not for me. Not because the job was bad or not because anybody was particularly difficult. I mean, not at all. Like, I love that job. But I realized that, you know, if I get promoted to be an executive, I'm going to inherit a lot of projects from the executive before me and the one before them. And I just said, nah, this doesn't feel right. So I said, I need to start writing right away. Yeah. So I started writing Sandcastle every morning from 7 a.m. to 8 a.m. And by the way, I had like an hour commute from my place downtown to his office in Santa Monica. So I'd get up super early and I'd drive, you know, when the 10 wasn't so busy, all the way across town. I'd write from 7 to 8 in the morning. And then from 8 a.m. to 8 or 8:30 p.m., I'd work his desk. And I did that for a year. And it was a very dark, difficult time. But at the end of it, I had a screenplay and I gave it to one of my coworkers. Her name's Sarah Smith, who's still an executive there and a hell of an executive. And I said, hey, take a look at this. And if you think it's good, just tell me to keep going. And that was kind of all that I expected. Like, I didn't expect to have a career. I didn't expect to get agents or managers or any of that shit. I just was like, tell me I should keep going because I've been doing this for a year. And if I suck at it, like, someone needs to stop me because I can't keep getting up early in the morning. Like, I hate it. Mm-hmm. But she read it that Friday night, and then Sunday evening, that same weekend, legitimately, I'm not trying to be, you know, hyperbolic, but like, my life totally changed by Sunday night.
Wow.
I got a call from Mark, who was in London with his family, and he called me, and I'm freaking out because I thought maybe I forgot to book his hotel or something. And I thought, like, you know, him and his family are out in the rain and they're getting robbed at gunpoint. And he's like, okay, before you kill me, like, let me call my assistant and fucking lay into him, you know, like, that's that's what I'm thinking. But he called me and he said, hey man, I don't know what's going on in LA, but Sarah gave me your script and I read it, and this is something. It's not done. I have notes, but this is something. And when I get back, we're gonna sit down and we're gonna spend 3 lunches every week, going over the script. I know it's incredible. It really is incredible. And he said, if we don't finish what we set out to, then you'll come over to my house at night. My wife will make dinner and we'll stay up till 1 or 2 in the morning if we have to. And we did that for 3 months until it was done. And he basically said, what the hell are you still doing here? Go home, go be a writer. Like, stop doing this job. I don't know why you're still doing this. and thus began the career, you know?
Wow, that's amazing. So, the script started circulating around town at some point. How did you make that happen?
Well, once Mark kind of got behind it, things moved rather quickly. And this is, by the way, like, you know, if the subtext of the lesson I'm trying to impart isn't being, you know, totally clear, like, let me make this clear. It is crucial to have a mentor of some kind or a singular person who cares about your growth and cares about the project that you're working on. Like, that's all that it takes, right? Like, a singular person.
And
also, to be clear, it wasn't Mark right away. It was my friend and coworker, Sarah, right? That's what it was. But I mean, to answer your question, after Mark got involved and said, this matters, I think this is good and I've worked on it, and, you know, we're both invested in it now. It made the rounds pretty quick, and all the meetings started, and then I got to do the, you know, I got to take some, like, a week off work to go do the dog and pony show, where you go around, you know, all the agencies and management companies, and everyone tells you you're a fucking genius, and then you leave, then you leave, and another guy comes in, another girl comes in, and then they're a fucking genius, you know, all that kind of thing. So I did that for a week, and then, you know, eventually, you know, found my team and started working.
Wow, that's great. So you picked up people you liked at that point, representatives that you liked.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's, you know, writing careers shift and change over time, and your needs shift and change over time. But everything that I needed at that point, at that, like, crucial, you know, beginning of my career, was totally, totally well served.
Yeah, yeah, of course. Now, how much longer until you actually made the blacklist with this script? Because that was a big moment, right?
Yeah, it was a huge moment, and legitimately totally unexpected, even with all the stuff that was happening behind it. But I think we went out with it October of 2012, and then it was on the blacklist December of 2012. So everything happened very, very quickly, and it was that last half of 2012 was quite difficult and exciting. But, you know, as a quick aside, my wife is also a writer, and she had been struggling for a long time as well. And she had just gotten staffed on this brand new show called The Americans, and we had to pack up and move to New York.
Wow.
at the same time. So it was a lightning bolt for both of us.
Wow.
And we'd both been struggling for, you know, the better part of a decade. And it happened all at once. So, you know, that entire stretch of 2012 was kind of a exciting, you know, nightmare and happy nightmare, all of those things at once, you know?
That's great. Wow. I mean, that's really cool that all that happens at once. And then how do you pick what you're going to do? So you guys moved to New York, and then you're still taking meetings? Are you trying to get this thing made at this point?
Yeah. My expectation of getting the film made was pretty much zero. Again, even on the blacklist, my expectation was zero, because having worked in development, I kind of know a lot of the scripts that get passed around, and, like, I'm not trying to shit on anybody or shit on scripts, but, like, there's a lot of scripts that are written that are just for attention, right? Like, just to get your name talked about. And, like, I've never really been down with that. Like, writing a script is really hard. I just don't know why you would do it to get, like, an executive's attention. I just don't care. So, like, my understanding was of working in that world is, like, no one's going to pass around, like, a war film to read on the weekend, you know? I just didn't think, never even entered my mind. But now that we're at the time in New York and this stuff is circulating, and it made the blacklist while I was in New York, everything kind of changed again. And I sort of had to leave her in New York, and I'd fly back for a week, and I'd go back to New York for a couple of days, and I'd fly back for a week and take meetings and go back for a couple of days.
Wow.
And it was a very exhausting and expensive time.
Sure.
Yeah.
Were you landing your own gigs at this point?
Yeah, I mean, there were things that were coming my way, some of which I was interested in, and some not so much. But typically what happens is, if you make the blacklist, and I've had plenty of friends who've been on it as well, and, like, their experience kind of mirrors mine, which is you go on the big water cooler tour. You know, I think I kept a spreadsheet of all my generals, and I did, like, 112 generals.
Wow.
Which is just, like, general meetings, right?
Yeah.
So you go into these generals, and each and every one of these companies have, like, a long list of projects that are totally dead, right? Just, like, projects in development that aren't going anywhere. Mm-hmm. And every time, like, a new kid, you know, a new guy, new girl makes the blacklist, like, it's a perfect opportunity to, like, dump some of that shit on them and resurrect, you know, some of their, you know, ill-fated projects. And that was, of course, my experience as well. Like, I go to each and every one of these companies, and based on the script that I wrote, they'll like throw action movies at me or dramas at me. And it's just like all the stuff that's been like languishing for the most part. You know, I tried to do my homework in advance and sort of see if there was something that they had that I was excited about. Or even better than that, I highly recommend, if you're a writer, having a long list of things that if you had political capital, you would expend it to get something like X, Y, and Z made. Like, I have this this list I call my crush list, which is something I kind of picked up from development. And it's like a list of articles, books, that if I have the opportunity, if I have some political capital to spend, like, I'm going to spend it on one of these things. And I highly recommend keeping a list like that, because if you find yourself doing the water cooler tour, as opposed to people dumping their bullshit on you, you can say, look, I have this, this is what I'm interested in, and if you don't want to do this, that's fine, but I'm looking for something like this, and they can go out and try to help you find it. Like, I'm a firm believer that that being a writer is a leadership position. And for whatever reason, I feel like we forget that quite often.
Right, right. Oh, that's awesome. Well, let's take a second here and just, why don't you pitch us, or at least give us the synopsis of Sandcastle?
Yeah, I mean, I think Netflix has written up something that sounds way better than I'll probably say off the cuff, but but basically, it's inspired by true events. It's inspired by my experience in the Iraq War, and it follows a platoon of soldiers who are tasked with repairing a water pumping station in a small farming village called Bakuba. And they think it's going to be very easy. We're going to show up. We're going to replace some pipes. And I think one soldier jokes that it's going to be like a photo op. It's kind of like a bullshit mission. But what they find is that it is anything but. The town is riddled with insurgents. There's a lot of mistrust. And also, we need the help of the Iraqi people in order to solve this problem. So tensions kind of boil over, and it becomes sort of a Sisyphean task of like rolling this boulder up a hill and watching it roll back down over and over and over again.
Yeah, and it just gets more and more complicated along the way.
Yeah, absolutely.
So when, I mean, one of the biggest things you have to do as a screenwriter is choose what you're going to write, and you had a lot of experiences in Iraq. What made you land on this?
I think it's something that I arrived at. You know, I got back from Iraq. I was 20, and I didn't start writing the screenplay. Like, I didn't even write a word of the screenplay till I was 27. Mm-hmm. And I think there was a lot of, again, like, I had to arrive at what it is that I wanted to even talk about. Like, how you collapse a year and change into a 2-hour movie. It's really hard. But like, what I ultimately arrived at after all those years of kind of thinking about it is, you know, what makes the Iraq War experience unique versus Vietnam or World War II or what have you. And for my money, I felt like what made it different is our mission depended upon our ability to earn the trust of the local populace. Mm-hmm. And I hadn't seen that articulated in cinema really at all. So that was really, really important to me. And it was also important to me that the portrayal of the American soldiers be as true to life as possible. And what I mean by that is they should be young, you know, like, yeah. I feel like we have this idea of what an American soldier sort of looks like based on the cinema that exists, right? Like, they're, you know, 45 years old and they're like a movie star and they deadlift 1,000 pounds and just all this like garbage, right? You know, it's like, it's, and listen, it's fun, it's entertaining. And I'm not saying that like that's not true for some folks, but like, people need to keep in mind that the average age of someone who was killed in action in Iraq is like 20 or 22, maybe at the most. Wow. And I don't know why we shy away from showing that, because I mean, I'll be straight up with you. There's kids I know who were 20, 21 at the time, who had a GED. They're from Arkansas, and they were pumping gas like 3 months before the war. Mm-hmm. And now they're like saving their friends' lives, and they're taking bullets. And that matters. Like, we should have as much of a nuanced understanding of what the American soldier looks like as possible. And when I realized that, then I started writing.
Wow. Wow. Yeah, it does a lot to really battle the stereotypes of the soldiers. And you know what occurs to me that as I say that out loud, even the Iraqi people, I mean, there's just a, I didn't feel like I was necessarily seeing people from a different culture. It felt so close to this guy runs a school and he's going to come up and talk because he wants to help.
I mean, and by the way, like, I know that given the state of, politics now, people will think that there's some sort of like political agenda behind it. But like, people must remember that this thing was written, in 2012, right? So I've been very adamant, and everyone I've talked to, in saying like this thing has been and as always has been aggressively apolitical, and as true to my experience as possible, right? Like, there's no funny business going on to like force the Iraqi people to work with American soldiers. Like, that was my experience day in and day out. And like, again, it matters to have this portrayed in cinema. It really
It
does.
does, yeah. It does a lot to combat those stereotypes, I think.
Yeah, I sure hope so.
Sure. So when did this start going into production and what happened for you, or how are you involved at the beginning?
Yeah, so I was heavily involved getting everything sort of up and running. Like, I held off selling the script for as long as possible, so I could maintain as much control as possible. But then, once you start hiring other folks and financiers come in and all that sort of stuff, you become more and more marginalized, which, by the way, I think is healthy. I want to be very clear about that. Like, it's very healthy that things sort of start to take shape on their own. But I did spend 3.5 months in Amman, Jordan, all through pre-production, all through production, and I got to spend some time in the editing bay, which was great. I mean, again, to like to what effect, I don't really know, but like, but the purpose, but the point being that like, I tried to like position myself as much as possible every step of the way so that I at least had a voice. People can discard that if they like. That's their business. But as long as like my notes documents are going somewhere, you know what I mean? I'm not just like watching dailies and, going, okay, best of luck, everybody.
Right.
I at least can be heard. That's kind of the best you can hope for.
Right, of course. So what was it like to see this actually come together on the screen when you're watching those dailies?
It was a kind of like an emotionally joyous and battering experience, right? Like, there's parts of the movie, especially early on, that I think are pretty hilarious, and I think the characters can be pretty goddamn funny. And that brought me like a lot of joy, but like underneath all of this, right, is the reality that some of these guys that I'm watching on the screen are no longer with us, and that was always very hard. It was hard watching it in dailies. It's hard watching it in the completed film, and it was really hard watching it when we were making the thing, right? Like, there are times where, I know that this is a time where XYZ character gets hurt or gets killed, and as the writer, it's sort of like, man, I can do whatever I want. I could make this happen differently. Like, I could take these events that have been with me for 10 plus years, that I've never forgotten about, and I can make them happen differently. And like, and I really wanted to, like, it was a real struggle not to change those things because it would make me feel better. But ultimately, you realize like that would do a disservice to like the things that some of these folks did. So I think like, I don't know. I mean, I feel like I'll hopefully go on and make other movies that are like lighter popcorn fare, and I probably won't be as attached to them. But given the fact that this is, about an experience that I'm very close to, and about people that I knew, it wasn't like an easy thing to go through. Like, it did kind of take its toll, but ultimately, I think it's worth it.
Yeah, for sure. It really comes across. So I want to ask, what are you working on now? This is just about out as we record this. So what's next for you?
I've been really, really lucky the past couple years. I've had a, it's just one of those things where it's like, something gets going and you kind of find yourself on a conveyor belt and all this stuff sort of happens. And I don't know how long that'll continue. So I'm trying to like revel in it for a second. I adapted a book for Pearl Street for Ben Affleck to direct, which was one of the great joyous experiences of my young career. I wrote a movie for Universal I just finished with this director, Baltazar Kormáker, who did Everest, with him attached to direct. I just started adapting a book for television. I'm really interested in television. I'd like to sort of steer myself that way.
Sure.
One thing that I'm really passionate about that I haven't quite found yet is I really want to do like my what I call coming home narrative, you know, like I don't want to do anything set in Iraq again. I'm not super pumped about doing a war movie, even though I get a lot of those. Mm-hmm. But I would very much like to tackle something that has to do with like reassimilating.
I like that idea a lot. I mean, I think just from the way we talked about it, that's a really interesting idea. I'd like to see more of that.
Yeah. I think it's one of those things that, If I were fortunate enough to find something and tackle it, I think doing it like in a miniseries space would be most ideal, because again, like as I've learned, there are real limitations to the cinematic medium. You know, 2 hours is not a long time, and you kind of have to like shoot the bullet out of the gun and kind of fly. But if you want to like ruminate on things that are a little bit tougher, then you know, television or miniseries is kind of the way to go.
Right, you really have the time to expand.
Yeah.
As we wrap it up here, what's the one piece of advice you give to other writers out there who are looking at what you've done or like your work? What would you say to them?
First of all, I feel like in no position to offer anybody advice about anything. But what I would say is that it's really important to have a clear picture of what it is you're doing here and why you want to do this at all. And I don't mean that in some kind of like trite glib way. I mean, like, this is it's really hard to get movies made, and it's really hard to make a living doing this. So I feel like, and by the way, like, if you want to like express yourself, you can write books and you can paint, you can write poems, millions of ways to express yourself. So the question I think that a person has to grapple with, like, at the beginning of their career and probably throughout the entirety of their career, is, you know, why this? Why does this matter to me that much? And that answer may change over time, but I think it's important to know what that answer is at any given day. Because, you know, you're going to have to get up tomorrow and you're going to have to sit in front of your computer and work, even though all your buddies are probably out having a much better time than you. You know, like, I think this job can bring, like, great joy. But it doesn't come for free, you know, and I feel like it's important to kind of come to terms with that and understand why it matters so much to you to give this a go. And as long as you have that answer, again, even if it shifts, if you have that answer on a day-to-day basis, then it makes it a lot easier to kind of navigate any bumps in the road, because there's something that you're trying to do. There's something that you're trying to give. That matters to you very much. I know I wish there was some less writer voodoo way for me to answer that question. but that's kind of where I'm at right now. I'm just sort of like in philosophical headspace. You know, it's like, it's a very weird time to, you know, it's a really weird time to catch me, because I've never made a movie before. You know what I mean? And this is all very odd.
Right. All right. Well, the next movie, we'll ask you again and see what you've learned from doing two of these.
Right.
But very happy to have you on, Chris. Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, my pleasure, man. Really appreciate it.
And if you're out there and you like this podcast, you can help others find it by leaving a rating or review on iTunes. Let other people know how much you like this. Until then, I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro, signing off. Thanks so much.